Good morning. Thanks for being here. Many thanks to a whole host of folks. You'll hear from my key sponsor in the Senate, Senator DeFrancisco, momentarily, along with a few others. But I just want to say this press conference is to talk about a bill to provide to address the funding for indigent legal services by the state of New York. The legislation would require that the state phase in a reimbursement of counties for providing indigent legal services and eliminate what has been a geographic disparity that we believe prevents New Yorkers from receiving better and more effective representation. As you know, the history of this began with the landmark ruling over 50 years ago, the Gideon versus Wainwright Supreme Court ruling that declared it is a fundamental right of all persons in the United States to be represented by counsel in criminal proceedings. In New York State, that ruling was implemented, but the cost of that representation was passed down to the counties. And fast forward to 10 years ago, passed, the former Chief Justice Judith Kaye labeled the state of our public defense system an ongoing crisis. And as we know, many counties do not have a system for supervising caseloads or standards to ensure comparable compensation or comparable representation for defenders. So we're here today because we have recognized that this has been a fairness issue. We commend the governor for settling the five-county lawsuit, the Hurl-Herring case, a year and a half ago, that recognized the need in those five counties. We'd like to see this addressed now throughout the rest of the state. This has become quite a burdensome, unfunded state mandate at a time when balancing local and county budgets is all the harder. But the most important reason that we're here, of course, is that this is the right thing to do, to provide equitable justice throughout the state. It was right 50 years ago when the Supreme Court ruled this as a constitutional right, and it's just as right now, 50 years later, and it's important that we provide better representation. I want to commend the governor for having recently proposed a host of criminal justice reforms, particularly with regard to youth. And we believe that providing this access to legal counsel in every county, adequate and appropriate legal counsel, is a critical piece of this reform, and we welcome the opportunity to work with him and all the others. There's many thanks to a host of people that have been involved in this. I'm going to turn to Senator DeFrancisco momentarily, but I need to do a shout out to Albany County Dan McCoy. Former Judge Larry Rosen brought this idea to me just over a year ago on behalf of the county executive, and I think this is close to a $4 million cost within the county.
It'd be more like 12 million.
Okay. Well, it's
every day.
Yes, maybe that's the 1/4. But it is millions of dollars across the state, quite a burden. And former Judge Rosen, as well as the county exec, are very committed to the need to provide appropriate legal services, but also recognize this tremendous burden. So I want to start then with Senator DeFrancisco, and couldn't be more pleased to have his sponsorship in the Senate.
Thank you. And thank you for setting up this news conference to publicize this important legislation. You know, this is really simple. This is really, really simple. And there can't possibly be anyone who's opposed to this. The way all this started was five counties brought a lawsuit, and a shout out to Suffolk, Washington, Ontario, Onondaga, which I represent, and Schuyler. They brought a lawsuit and said that we should be provided funding. There's a constitutional right that the state of New York, a duty that the state of New York has to provide indigent legal services. And they used their funds to bring a lawsuit, and they arrived at an agreed upon settlement that became the order in the case. The order in the case basically provided for those five counties to get reimbursed by the state for indigent legal services and to provide some oversight so that there's a common commonality of all those five counties. So the state of New York has agreed with those five counties. The other counties didn't bring the lawsuit, but they still are counties in the state of New York. They still have individuals who are arrested. They still have people that are indigent that have to go to court, and they're still paying the legal services for the residents of their county as the Constitution requires. So all this bill does, it's very simple. The state's already agreed to this, but all counties have to be provided for in the same way. Now, is anybody here against that? Somebody give me an argument against that. I mean, there's no possible argument against that. So that's what this bill does. There's going to be some refinements as this the settlement is worked through. And the governor did put money in the budget this year to comply with the settlement for those five counties. So what we're trying to do is to make it across the board, upstate, downstate. The governor is in many cases, in just this one speech, the state of the state. We're one state. Well, if we're one state, we all should be treated the same way. So that's what this bill does. And if you agree with this, spread the word, because there's no possible opposition. You can't be caught in any political bind. You can't possibly offend anybody because the government has already agreed to this. So thanks to Assemblywoman Fahey and all the people that are here supporting this bill, but we got to spread this across the entire legislature in order to get this thing done, hopefully this year in this budget process. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. I really very much appreciate you championing this, and I couldn't be more pleased with already the bipartisan support that has been shown for this in both bodies, and really look forward to moving and accelerating this. With that, I want to turn to, I've been working on this for the last year, and we've had many good conversations over the last year. There are many of you in the audience and behind me who have worked on this issue for decades, and I couldn't be more appreciative of your work. And with that, I want to turn to our chairman of the Codes Committee, Chairman Joe Lentil.
We all clap for Joe.
Thank you very much, Pat. I'll try not to be repetitive in what's already been said. You know what the issue is. But I want to tell you what the real issue is, even though the issue is always money in this state. But the real issue involves our faith in the criminal justice system. We have a crisis in our criminal justice system, in case any of you haven't noticed, and it's not only in New York State, it's throughout the country. We have people who no longer believe in our law enforcement personnel because of crimes that are committed against unarmed citizens throughout the country. We have a crisis that's brewing in other aspects of our criminal justice system, including our courts. But what we don't really think about is trying to level the playing field, as we always say in Albany. And the criminal justice system is not only the police, it's not only the courts, it's all of the entire system itself that is in crisis. And why is it in crisis? Because obviously we don't have the money to do the job that's necessary in order to fund the criminal justice system. But what about the prosecution of cases? Are they funded? The government isn't stingy when it comes to funding prosecutorial resources, is it? We have plenty of money to root out the causes of crime and to try and prosecute individuals. But when it comes to defending them, we have many indigent defendants throughout the state. Now, my county in Brooklyn doesn't suffer from this because we have a caseload management system in place that funds indigent defense. Does it have enough? No. It doesn't have enough because the prosecution will always have more resources than the defense. So what we're calling for here could be monumental, in my opinion, in being able to make this criminal justice system fairer by providing indigent defense the same kind of resources that the prosecution gets so that we have a fair fight when we go to court. That's what this is all about, after all, isn't it? A fair fight. Not a fight that we have to have documentaries on television explaining to us how you can make a murderer. Now, there are both sides to the story when it comes to that documentary, and I'm not going to take sides. But you have to understand that the criminal justice system is lacking, and the result is wrongful convictions and people going to jail who don't belong there. Today's press conference is really about correcting that, to make indigent defense just as viable and just as strong as prosecution of cases. So I want to commend Assemblywoman Fahey and Senator DeFrancisco for taking this opportunity, even though Onondaga County is was a participant in the lawsuit and hopefully will be fully funded. We have to do the entire state, and this is an opportunity for Governor Cuomo to come up with the money and really be a hero in the area of criminal justice reform. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. We have had many senators chomping at the bit to get a bill like this put together because it affects their counties, it affects their people. And one of the people I heard the most from is Senator Ritchie. She's very vocal, very persistent, and very right. And I'd just like to introduce her for a few words.
I'm certainly glad to be here today. As a former county clerk, I've seen firsthand what unfunded mandates do across the state on our county's bottom line, whether it be St. Lawrence, Jefferson, or Oswego that I represent, or other counties across the state. This bill will allow our counties to stay underneath the tax cap, continuing to send much-needed tax relief to taxpayers across the state. So this is something that must be done. I certainly commend Senator DeFrancisco and Assemblywoman Fahey for putting this forward, something I'm certainly thrilled to support. And I know my counties are looking forward to the relief that this bill will bring them. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Really, and appreciate the calls and appreciate all the support as well over these last few months. With that, I just want to call for some brief remarks as well from Assemblyman McDonald and Assemblywoman Addie Russell, who have also been terrific co-sponsors here from the get-go. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Pat. And Pat, thanks to you and Senator DeFrancisco for your leadership on this bill. And as the Senator said, this is it is simple. And it's simple on two points. Number one, in this day and age when we're hearing about consolidation of governments, we recognize that that is just not a practical reality because of all the services that these communities provide. But what the state can do to be an effective partner is to look to absorb logically services that can be administered at the state level, relieving the burden to the local taxpayers. This is one thing that this bill does. And the second one, which is just as important as the first, it is ensures that every individual, no matter who they are throughout the state of New York, is provided proper and legal defense services. Thank you.
Thank you, and I appreciate everyone coming to really pay attention to this extremely important issue. I am Assemblywoman Addie Russell. I represent parts of Jefferson and St. Lawrence counties with my colleague, Senator Ritchie, and we are also joined by the county attorney in St. Lawrence County, Steve Button, who I suspect will be able to address you folks in a little bit of time. But I don't think it's new to anyone that the poorest communities in our states are the ones that need the most help in terms of providing services to those that are poor. And we really, our policies have not reflected that. And so our counties with the least ability to pay for these services are the counties that are really called upon the most to help support these services. You know, our counties are under significant fiscal distress, and the tax cap makes it even harder to ensure that we're really meeting all the needs of our citizens. So, you know, I stand here today to advocate not really for three distinct, you know, advocacy groups. I think it's all one. But to understand the plight of our counties, to understand that they're doing all that they can, and it's really not their fault that they're falling behind in being able to provide these services. We ought to recognize at the state level, and that's why I stand here today, that it is important for the state to play a major role in ensuring that constitutional rights are provided to all of its citizens. But I stand here on behalf of my constituents that deserve to be more than just a case number, that they're kind of herded into court and their lawyer may only have looked at their file for the couple of minutes while they're going up to, you know, to the bench, essentially, to sit down with their counsel. You know, we have relatively few lawyers in the North Country that are overworked and overburdened, and, you know, that unfortunately has an impact on the service that they're able to give to their clients. And so I stand here today on behalf of those that are charged with crimes and their lawyers to say we need to have something that's more workable and that really puts an emphasis on justice instead of warehousing and kind of moving through clients like they're just a file number. But as my colleagues have also said, this is about our justice system. You know, we need to ensure that people feel the justice system has integrity, that it's working correctly. If you do not have faith in your system of justice, you really do not have a well-working society. And so, you know, I am glad to stand here shoulder to shoulder with such distinguished members of the legislature and of our state to say that this is what is absolutely necessary for a well-run democracy. Thank you very much.
It's the last time I'm getting up here. I'm going to introduce one other person, and then I know what everyone else is going to say. I have a meeting I have to be at very, very shortly. But I do want to introduce one other senator who's here, Senator Amador from the Capital Region. You know, I've been here a long time. I think this is my 24th year, but at my age, I can't really remember. But I do know one thing. There's a lot of senators that have come and gone throughout our chambers, and I don't remember any that have had such an immediate impact in the Senate of a new senator like George Amador. He's an outstanding senator. He's well respected and he's listened to, and he's definitely strongly behind this. And Senator Amador is going to make a brief remark now.
Oh. Well, thank you, Senator DeFrancisco and Assemblywoman Fahey. Great day. I love standing shoulder to shoulder with my partner, County Executive Dan McCoy, on an issue that really is simple, and it was already said. Unfunded mandates, check it off. Property or taxpayer protection, check it off, because this brings about exactly what we've been trying to do for so many years, and how we can get New York State more affordable, make it more affordable, and make it more fair and balanced. And finally, bringing justice for all, and an equal justice for all, which is so important. So thank you, I support you, and let's get this done.
Thank you, Senator. It's terrific to have you. I know one of the very first as well, and have supported this from the get-go. Much, much appreciated. With that, I want to call on our county, Albany County Executive Dan McCoy, but I also want to acknowledge Rensselaer County Executive Kathy Gimeno, who has been terrifically supportive and more than recognizes the need and the burden that this has been on counties. Although it's the right thing to do, the counties have shouldered this burden, and much appreciated you being here in support of this.
Thank you. It's great to be here, standing here, because, you know, I'm on my second term as county executive, and I have to tell you, this is something that we've been championing for the last 4 years. But a year ago, when I reached out to our Assemblywoman Pat Fahey and John McDonald and Senator Amador, we talked about what we could do to make a difference. And almost a year ago to the date, we had a press conference. And I want to thank my staff, especially my Deputy County Executive Phil Calderon and Chris Quinn, who actually helped write this legislation. But it's not possible without a partnership. And I love standing up here with the Republicans and Dems. We forget about party affiliations, because this is about working for the people. And I can't commend Pat Fahey for your leadership and continuing on this. Pat, thank you for everything that you've done and continue to do to get this bill. And Senator DeFrancisco, who had to leave, but I can't thank him enough either, because this really gives this bill teeth. And it gives an opportunity at the light at the end of the tunnel to have relief. And it's just not about the relief. This affects 57 counties in upstate New York. It's approximately about $157 million, if I stand corrected, Steve Aquarius, New York State Association of Counties. I want to thank him especially, and all the county executives that are here, Marcus from Dutchess County, Mary Ellen from Putnam, Kathy Gemino, and all the other county executives that have signed on to this. Because it shows that this type of relief, and when we talk about property tax caps, it's going to help us achieve this. And we look at it at that point. But the most important thing to me is giving fair representation to people that can't afford it. We look at Kaleef, what happened in New York City when he spent 3 years in prison because he didn't get fair representation. We look at what happens here in Albany County and around this great capital. We want to give people the fair representation that Judge Kaye talked about over 10 years ago when she put that commission together. And here it is 10 years later, and we're still talking about it. This really gives an opportunity to treat people fairly in a system that they're not being treated fairly in. And when, as the governor talks about reform and lower the age, and we talk about all these great other things to do in the justice system, but we're not talking about until Assemblywoman Fahey and Senator DeFrancisco and all the senators and assembly members that are here is about the money. If we put the right money into the system, maybe we wouldn't need jails. Maybe we wouldn't need to lower the age. Maybe the people that we're representing would get fair representation in the courtroom and not end up in the jail. So if you look at it from that point of view, it really has an impact, not just on the fiscal side of it for us counties, but on the fact of someone's human life. And that's what it's about. So again, I thank everyone for being up here in a partnership, and I appreciate your time.
Thank you again. Much appreciated. And with that, I want to turn to Steve Aquario with NYSAC. And Steve has just been terrific from day one on this in mobilizing support, getting the word out, and really helping to educate all of us as well on this need. So thank you, Steve.
Thank you, Assemblywoman Fahey. Can I ask the county executives that are here to just kind of join me here for just some brief remarks, Dan, as well, if we could all just kind of get in close together here. Ladies and gentlemen, these are the county executives, some of the representatives here who actually levy the property tax to fund a federal constitutional mandate. Not the state of New York, which is how most states in the union provide this constitutional protection, but the local tax funding a federal constitutional right. The county executives of Albany, Rensselaer, Putnam, and Dutchess County are here with us today. I want to thank the bill sponsors, Assemblywoman Pat Fahey, Senator John DeFrancisco. Thank the public defenders who provide this service. Thank the lawyers of this great state and our assigned counsel program who work tirelessly to protect those in need of justice. But today we call on the state to right a wrong. We have the wrong system of justice in New York State, and it's preventable. There are, of course, many priorities facing the state. The governor outlined several of them in his State of the State. But this issue, access to justice, must be one of them. We need one system of justice in the state, not one for the five counties, New York City, and the 57 others. Equal access to justice should prevail statewide. And this is the state's responsibility, obligation, not the local governments and the local taxpayers. This legislation that's being introduced today is real historical mandate relief. It comes at a crucial time. We call upon the state to implement these changes as part of the governor's budget negotiations, which are taking place today. And historically, the change in this program has happened and come from the state legislature. We need their active role in this participation, in this process that's going to take place these next several months. Let me call your attention to a few charts that we brought with us here today. This is what the local governments in New York are spending right now for the federal mandate, just about $360 million. State share, that small slice in the top left corner, $82 million. That should be the other way around. How did we get into this situation where local taxes are funding $600 million with the state, that small piece? If we look here, Pat, if you could put that chart up there. We've heard some comments today from some of the members of the state legislature about the property tax cap. We needed a property tax cap. It was too high in this state. But look at the amount of the levy growth the counties are able to spend. Just shy of $30 million total for the 57 counties for all of the mandates we have to provide. And the cost to implement this program, should it go statewide, $115 million. Unsustainable. We can't carry it on our tax levy. The state of New York has to fund this program. And that's why we're calling on this campaign for Fix the 52. Those were the five counties who got the fix in the lawsuit, and New York City as well, who has caseload caps in the standards and additional enhanced state funding that Assemblyman Lentol spoke about. But the rest of the state in gray needs the fix. And I'd like to offer any county executive that might have a comment to make before I step down. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I will be quick. I think so much has been said about this bill, and I am very grateful to Assemblywoman Fahey and Senator DeFrancisco and all the other sponsors of this bill. This is critical. Let me make one additional point, though. When you look at the fact that we have a tax cap in place, it is very appropriate because our taxes here, our local taxes in New York State, are 80% higher than the national average. We need to provide relief to our property taxpayers. When we are forced to increase spending for one program, we're forced to decrease spending elsewhere. What we end up doing is pitting one vulnerable population against another, whether it is indigent folks who need representation in court, or whether it is our seniors who are trying to stay in their homes and not have to pay more in property taxes, whether it is our youth programming where we're trying to keep young people out of trouble and set them on a good course for life. This is what happens when we finance so much of the state programs on a property tax basis. We pit one vulnerable group, one needy group against another. That shouldn't happen. When it's financed at a state level, we don't have that problem, and we're providing much-needed property tax relief to our families and businesses. So I wholeheartedly support this bill and will do whatever I can to make sure that it gets passed. Thank you.
I guess I'm going to be the MC for us. Mary Ellen O'Dell from Putnam County, Putnam County Executive. I'm Mark Molinaro, Dutchess County Executive. We're thankful to the sponsors. I may be the only county executive to have voted for the tax cap and now have to live within it. And I'm confident we can do that. I'm confident we can do that, and I'm grateful to the members of my former colleagues, members of the legislature, who are so supportive in moving this legislation forward. Thanks.
Thanks. Thanks so much. And Steve, love your enthusiasm, and we'll be sure to make copies of the posters to bring those around. So much appreciated. And I know we have a lot of work ahead of us, and this is a great start. With that, I want to turn to our State Bar Association, who has also just been terrific in recognizing the need and in supporting this. And if we could, Dave Miranda, hear from him.
Thanks, Dave. Thank you very much. Thank you all for staying. Usually when they say State Bar President, it clears the room. I'm Dave Miranda, President of the New York State Bar Association. It's my real honor and privilege to stand here with my assembly person, Pat Fahey, and also privileged to be involved in legislation and joined with the Deputy Majority Leader, John DeFrancisco. With whom we've had the privilege of working on many issues over the years, along with others that are here that on both sides of the aisle that we have worked with. Our association has been long been a leader in advocating for the provision of legal services for the poor and otherwise disadvantaged. Over 100 years ago, the New York State Bar Association created a committee dedicated to that issue and endorsed the concept of public defenders to provide representation to indigent defendants. In 2004, then Chief Judge Judith Kaye created a commission on the future of indigent defense services to examine New York State's indigent criminal defense system. And the entire state mourned our loss of former Chief Judge Kaye earlier this month. Her commission's report in 2006 concluded that there is a crisis in the delivery of defense services to the indigent throughout New York State, and that the right to the effective assistance of counsel guaranteed by both the federal and state constitutions is not being provided to a large portion of those who are entitled to it. This finding was both alarming and disheartening. Since then, there have been developments in New York State to address this issue. In 2010, our state leaders created the Office of Indigent Legal Services, an important step that the State Bar Association strongly supported. Our association continues to urge independent oversight of public defense, quality assurance, support, and resources to to providers of mandated representation and appropriate funding and reform. Our system of justice is founded on the premise that all men and women will be treated fairly and equally before the law. As Martin Luther King, whose birthday we celebrated earlier this week, said, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." Today, our Bar Association urges that the legislature and the governor take another important step in the right direction by enacting the Fahey DeFrancisco bill in order to provide state funding and ensure appropriate rules and standards for the provision of indigent legal services. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, and much appreciate the support. Our last speaker is in some ways the most enthusiastic, and that is our St. Lawrence County attorney, Steve Button, who has been really terrific in helping to get the word out, along with Jonathan Gredes and a whole host of others in the audience, that we really have appreciated the work that's been done on this. And Steve, if you would.
Good morning. This issue is very special to me in a number of different ways. Many folks who know me know that prior to my involvement as the county attorney for St. Lawrence County, I was the county public defender. I spent a large portion of my time seeking out resources, seeking out funding to assist a very strained office to carry out constitutionally mandated representation in indigent defense. As a county attorney of a fiscally stressed county, I now spend a lot of my time looking for additional resources to assist that county and its 26 departments carry out all of its constitutionally mandated functions. This is an opportunity, as I think Assemblyman Lintel identified, Assemblywoman Fahey identified, Assemblywoman Russell identified, Senator Ritchie identified, Senator Amador identified, to marry two great principles. One is the principle that we are providing unfunded mandate relief to fiscally strained counties that can no longer afford the burden that has been thrust upon them. But two, we are doing so in such a way as to carry out our societal obligation and our constitutional obligation to provide indigent defendants with the counsel that the Sixth Amendment calls for. I am very appreciative to be here with the individuals that are standing behind me and that were here earlier. Obviously, they have heard the cries of the counties, they have heard the cries of their constituents, and they are demonstrating true leadership by bringing these bills forth. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for your patience, everybody. And there's a lot of work ahead, but the enthusiasm and the support is making all the difference, particularly that it's bipartisan, particularly that it's coming from across the state. And Steve, by the way, I do love the tagline, the Fix the 52, and that did come from Steve, by the way.